This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. In this video, we're going to be talking about classifying matter. Let's begin by talking about what matter is. Matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. Matter can be in the solid, the liquid, or the gas phase. So the air that you breathe is considered matter. It has a mass and it takes up space. Some of the few things that are around us that are not considered matter are light and sound. Light and sound are some of the few examples of things that are not matter. This is a flowchart designed to help us determine how to classify matter. We're going to be coming back to this several times as we discuss the different ways that matter can be organized. To begin with, matter is broken apart into pure substances and mixtures. So let's take a few minutes and talk about what a pure substance is. The first example that I have here is an element. Elements are made up of atoms. Atoms are considered the smallest particle of an element. We'll go later into details about the individual parts of an atom, but for now recognize that an atom is the smallest individual particle that makes up an element. The atoms of each type element are unique. What I mean by that is that carbon atoms are different from gold atoms, which are different from hydrogen atoms. On our flowchart, I've used a picture to try to help you visualize what is going on with an element. I've used a series of dots that are all the same color to try to represent the fact that all of those atoms are the same. In order for an element to be a pure substance, everything about it is going to be the same. So each of these atoms is the same. Let's next talk about a compound, which is a different type of pure substance. Compounds are two or more elements chemically combined, meaning that a chemical reaction has taken place and these atoms are held together by a chemical bond. An example of a compound is sodium chloride, which is table salt. One thing to note is that compounds have different properties than the elements that form them. This is a great example because sodium, by itself, is a metal that reacts dangerously with water. Chlorine, by itself, is a poisonous gas, but when they form this new compound and come together to form table salt, you have something that you can eat and that is tasty on fries. So they have totally different properties when they're combined chemically than when they're separate. In our chart, I've used a picture of a blue and a pink dot to represent a compound. So you can see that each one of these particles has a blue and a pink dot that are held together by a chemical bond. This is considered a pure substance because every single particle has a blue and a pink dot. Later in the course, we'll go into details about the different types of bonds that hold compounds together. But for now, we're just going to go through a quick overview of what you should know about compounds as you start the course. One type of compound is a molecule. A molecule is a group of atoms that stays together as a unit, and it has a fixed ratio of the number of atoms present. For example, carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide will always consist of one carbon and two oxygen atoms that stay together as a unit. They are held together by chemical bonds. If you change the ratio of carbon to oxygen atoms, you have changed the molecule. For example, if you change this to one carbon and one oxygen atom, it would suddenly be carbon monoxide, a totally different compound with totally different properties. So a molecule has a fixed ratio of atoms. The fixed ratio of atoms that shows up in molecules and other types of compounds can be represented by a chemical formula. A chemical formula tells you the kind and the number of atoms present in a molecule. Water, for example, has one oxygen and two hydrogen atoms. The chemical formula for water has a capital H indicating the hydrogen And there's two of those, so there's a small subscript beside the H that lets me know that there are two of those hydrogen atoms. And then it has a capital O to indicate oxygen. So the elements tell us what type of atoms are present, and then the subscripts indicate the number of each type of atom. And the subscripts go with the element that is directly in front of them. If there are no subscripts present, you can assume that there is only one of that type of element. For example, there's only one oxygen. If you see parentheses, the subscripts go with everything that's inside the parentheses. It can be distributed into the parentheses. So in this example, there's one magnesium, there are two nitrogens, and then there are 2 × 3 oxygens. So magnesium nitrate has 1 magnesium, 2 nitrogens, and 6 oxygens. Another thing to point out about chemical formulas is that the capital letters matter. The first letter in an element is capitalized, and the second letter is not. Some elements have one letter, while some elements have 2 letters in their symbol. 2 capital letters in a row indicates that you have 2 separate elements. Let's look at an example. CO. Notice there's a capital C and a small O. That's the element cobalt. The fact that we've got the small O there indicates you have not changed elements yet. You're still talking about the same element. Cobalt is a silver metal that is sometimes used in magnets. If you change that to where you have a capital C and a capital O, that's 2 separate elements. When I see that next capital letter, I know that we are changing elements. This is totally different. That is carbon monoxide. It is an odorless, poisonous gas. So a chemist needs to be very careful when they're writing these compounds to make sure that they have capital letters in the correct place, because CO and CO may look the same, but they mean 2 very different things if that O is capitalized. Everything that we've talked about up to this point is considered a pure substance. Elements and compounds are considered pure substances. Let's now go this direction and talk about mixtures. Mixtures are combined physically. A chemical reaction is not necessary to create a mixture. An interesting thing about mixtures is that each particle within the mixture maintains its original properties. You have 2 types of mixtures. You have homogeneous mixtures, which are often called solutions. Homogeneous mixtures are the same throughout. A sample of any 2 parts of the mixture would have the same composition. So in my picture of a mixture, I have pink and blue dots. They are separated by a space to indicate that there is not a chemical bond between them, but there's a pattern to them, and what you would find in this area of the mixture is the same as what you would find in this area of the mixture, so that it is a homogeneous mixture. A heterogeneous mixture is not evenly mixed. Different samples of the mixture would give you different compositions. So in my picture, once again, they are not chemically combined, so there's a space between each of the particles. This portion is all pink dots, and this portion is all blue dots. They are not evenly mixed. Mixtures can be any combination of solid, liquid, and gases. A great example of a gas mixture is the air that you breathe. It's mostly nitrogen with oxygen, carbon dioxide, and water vapor mixed in. A mixture does not have to consist of things that are in the same phase. For example, soft drinks are liquid with carbon dioxide, which is a gas, mixed in. So that is an example where you have a liquid-gas mixture. So you can have any combination of these phases to be a mixture. Now that we've been through some examples of the different types of matter that you see on this chart, let's talk about the major difference between mixtures and pure substances. Mixtures can be separated using physical properties. That means you can separate the portions of a mixture without a chemical reaction taking place. Pure substances are different. You cannot separate a pure substance using physical properties. In the case of an element, you can't separate it any further. In the case of a compound, a chemical reaction is necessary to separate the pink and the blue dot. So chemical means are necessary to separate a compound, whereas in the case of a mixture, you can separate them using physical means. Two of the ways that we can separate mixtures are filtration and distillation. These are both using physical properties to separate the parts of the mixture. In the case of filtration, you're using a difference in the size of the particles. So in this picture, you have a filter set up here. The mixture would be dropped into here and solid particles would be caught by the filter. The liquid particles, which are smaller, go through the filter and are collected here. You have separated the mixture using a difference in the size of the particles. Distillation is a little different. Distillation depends on the difference in the boiling points of the parts of the mixture. So you would have two things mixed together. They have different boiling points. So when you apply heat, one of them boils off first. The gases come up through the chamber. They condense here and are collected over here. So a difference in boiling point has been used to separate the mixture. And boiling point is a physical property. That's the end of our first unit of chemistry. If you have found these videos helpful, I hope that you will like them and subscribe to chemistryismyjam.com.